In today's video, we are once again going to take a little bit of a break from the 2019 Stanley Cup playoffs and have a look at some interesting NHL trade rumors, some things that we might see happen during the offseason. Today, we're mainly focusing on a couple of teams, the Nashville Predators, the Minnesota Wild, and the Pittsburgh Penguins. We'll get into all that coming up next. Hey everyone, and welcome back to another video here at Top Shelf Hockey. If you're new to the channel, thanks for stopping by. We review and discuss all 31 NHL teams, so if you're a huge hockey fan, consider subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. So as I mentioned here, we're going to be taking a look at some NHL trade rumors today. A couple of these teams are teams that were recently eliminated from the playoffs, and after their year-end media availability, lots of talk and chatter has already begun on how they might process their offseason plans. And so let's take a look at things that are already being discussed here in the rumor mill. Let's get started with the Pittsburgh Penguins. Now, obviously, that's the second year in a row that they've had playoff disappointment. This whole year really has been a little bit of a struggle for the Penguins. They never had a guaranteed playoff spot. Really, all year they've been scratching and clawing their way between the wildcard spot, into that number three spot at times, the number two spot. Even at times they were out of the playoffs. They really had to work hard just to be a playoff team this year. So obviously things are not quite what they used to be with the Pittsburgh Penguins. In the latest reports here from Jason Mackey of the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette is really having a look at what they might be doing. And apparently general manager Jim Rutherford, who recently did an interview with him, really has pretty much everything on the table. There really isn't too much that they would not consider doing at this point in time. There's very few players on the Penguins roster that are kind of considered untouchable. There was even some speculation about Evgeny Malkin, but personally, I really don't think there's anything to that at all. Crosby and Malkin both have a full no trade clause, so they would both have to approve any trades out of Pittsburgh. I know both those guys have a great relationship with Mario Lemieux. I'm sure he wants them both to be lifelong Penguins. I don't see either of those guys ever going anywhere unless they themselves decided they wanted out and went to the general manager, Jim Rutherford, or to Mario Lemieux and expressed interest to leave, which I would be highly doubtful would ever happen. However, you know, that was out there. I just don't see it happening. I do see the possibility, though, that it could look to move some of the other guys, like we had mentioned last week, about possibility of Phil Kessel being moved. Obviously, Kessel has been a player who's been mentioned in trade rumors the last couple years, yet nothing has happened. But when at this point, I think the Penguins are open to doing just about anything, including Kessel. I think the defenseman Chris Letang is a player who could get some interest. You also got younger defenseman Ollie Mata, who's been mentioned before as well. Even other forwards like Patrick Hornqvist's name has come up recently as well. Although many do expect now that they will be making a big splash this summer and likely are going to be breaking up that core, at least to some extent. So it's hard to say exactly who is going to go. I mean, some of those guys are going to be proved difficult to trade for sure. Kessel does have a form of a modified no-trade clause where he can submit an 18 trade list. Chris Letang has a modified no-trade as well. I believe the way his works is that he has an 18-team list that he would accept a trade to. So obviously there's more teams there to work with than what Kessel provides. They still have three goalies on the roster, including Casey DeSmith and Tristan Jarry. I do suspect one of those guys likely gets moved. The way Casey DeSmith has played, though, recently, and over this past year especially, I think he's pretty well cemented himself as being the backup goalie here. So I would not be surprised if Tristan Jarry is a player that they look to move and maybe can bring back another asset they could use in another position here as well, if they're going to run with Murray and DeSmith for the foreseeable future, which does appear to be the plan. Now, Jim Rutherford, basically in his interview with Jason Mackey, indicated that he's still taking time to process it all. He's not really sure exactly what he's going to do. But obviously, between now and the NHL draft, a lot of hard decisions are going to have to be made as far as who they're going to likely look to move out, entertain some trade talks, see what happens. But I do expect one of the bigger names off the Penguins roster to likely be moved here before next season. Now, speaking of teams here that have kind of had a lot of success recently and failed to deliver this year, let's jump over and take a look at the Nashville Predators. Now, of course, a few years back, the Predators went to the finals against the Pittsburgh Penguins, and really ever since then have been struggling to get back there. The Predators have had back-to-back now regular seasons that were really solid following up that Stanley Cup Finals performance. When they went to the finals, that year the regular season wasn't nearly as strong. They went in as a much lower seed and went all the way to the finals as that Cinderella story, kind of. But really ever since, they've really been a powerhouse, having some fantastic regular seasons here. But obviously, again, this year, failed to deliver in the playoffs. Last year, they got beat out in round two against the Winnipeg Jets. And this year they go out in round one versus the Dallas Stars. So it's yet another step backwards instead of a step forward to get back to where they wanted to be that they were a couple years ago. But obviously with that series defeat being very fresh and they're going through their locker room cleanouts and all their post-end of the season here, media scrums and availability, there's already lots of talk around things that they might be looking to do. And a couple of names that have come up right away is PK Subban and Kyle Turris. Now, PK Subban and Turris both had disappointing years, not only in their regular season, but in the playoffs here as well. Neither one of them really came up big like they were hoping to do and what they're brought in to do. Obviously, the Nashville Predators do have a lot of money tied up in the salary cap as well. They got some extensions that need to be kicking in soon, like a Roman Josi extension, which is going to be, you know, certainly a big raise for what he's being paid today. So they need to make some hard decisions. They obviously need to make some changes because the formula they have now isn't quite working. And the PK Subban is certainly taking the brunt of the criticism and seems to be the biggest name out there on the Predators roster that could be moved to help strengthen other areas. Obviously, right now, their goaltending is pretty solid. Pecorine had another solid year. UC Saros is the goalie of the future, so they don't really need to do a whole lot in regards to goaltending. A lot of their other D-Corps members are, you know, pretty solid as well, but I think it's safe to say that they didn't quite live up to expectations this year, not just Subban, but even Ekholm as well. Even the season for Ryan Ellis wasn't as strong as they were hoping as well. But I do see the contract that he has as being much more team-friendly. And I think long-term, I think he's more likely to stick around. Whereas Subban still has another 3 years at that $9 million mark. That's an easy way to free up a lot of cap space and get a pretty good return. He's still young enough as well that a lot of other teams would certainly show interest, depending on their salary cap situation, of course, because it is a big cap hit to take on. But PK Subban very well might be a player that the Predators dangle this summer to try to improve other areas of their team. We know GM David Poile is not afraid to make big trades. He obviously, with guys like Turris and Subban, he made big trades to bring them in, so he won't be afraid to make big trades to send them out if he's able to get a deal that makes his team better. Of course, in Turris' situation, he had career lows this year in goals, assists, and points. Really didn't have a great playoff either, and at the end of the day here, he still has five more years, though, at $6 million. After being acquired from Ottawa in that three-way deal which sent Matt Duchene to the Senators, Turris then immediately signed a six-year, $6 million per year, so it's a $36 million total contract with the Predators. So they still owe him $30 million over the next 5 years and only putting up, you know, 23 points on the year. It's certainly not going to cut it here. He's expected to be a solid number two center behind Ryan Johansson, and that just has not happened here this past year. So that contract's going to prove very difficult for them to move. At the same time, you know, if they can find a taker, they certainly will explore that. Same thing with Subban, but they definitely need more depth scoring up front. Obviously, Johansson, Forsberg, and Arvidsson's been a solid line for them, but obviously, beyond that, they weren't getting the help that they needed here throughout the regular season and the playoffs. The power play needs work. So obviously, a lot of these guys could certainly help if they can find the right guys here to swap some players with. Now, of course, one player who came up before in trade talks that we discussed earlier last week as well is the real deal, James Neal. Obviously, him and Calgary did not have a very solid relationship this year. He signed with the Flames, probably thinking he was going to be on that top line with Monahan and Gaudreau. That never happened right out of the gate. They put Elias Lindholm there, and he played exceptionally well and never came out of that spot. So James Neal was relegated to lower line duty, playing a lot of second and third lines, and just could not get going. He just did not gel with those line mates and just did not have a James Neal type of season at all. Neal was even a healthy scratch late into the playoffs against the Avalanche there before they were beaten out. So could we maybe see a case of James Neal and Kyle Turris maybe being swapped for each other? That might actually be a real possibility. Not really sure that the Flames need another centerman. They do have some pretty decent depth of that position. Just kind of food for thought here for now, but that's going to be the type of deal that they need for Turris. It's going to be the type of deal the Flames need for James Neal. Obviously, the Preds are familiar with him as well. Just a quick food for thought there, but for both those players to move, that's going to be the type of deal that you need, is another player with a similar contract that did not work out, and maybe both teams kind of swap and hopefully get a fresh start and get those players reignited back to their old self. So at this point, we don't have any teams linked to the Predators trying to acquire Turris or Subban. It's a little bit early for that, but both those players could find themselves on the move if the right deal can be had here by the Predators this summer. Now, lastly here, I want to touch on a note from Elliot Friedman, who came up on a radio hit today talking about Minnesota Wild forward Jason Zucker and the Calgary Flames, as we we had discussed here on the channel around the NHL trade deadline shortly after it had passed, that the Flames and the Wild had a deal, or at least they thought they did, in place to send Jason Zucker from Minnesota to Calgary. It wasn't totally clear on what the return was going back to Minnesota, but that deal apparently fell apart for some reason at the last minute, did not get registered with the league, and therefore did not take place. But the Flames were under the impression that they had a deal lined up and was set to go here to acquire Zucker from the Minnesota Wild. So Daily Friedman's reporting that he would not be surprised at all to see those two teams reignite the trade talks and try to make this deal happen here over the offseason. Zucker's another player who signed a longer-term contract extension last summer, got $5.5 million per year. I believe he's got five more years left. Even though those numbers were not terrible, they certainly were a fairly decent decline from the year before when he was in his contract year and earned that new contract. He had scored 33 goals the year before, had over 60 points, and then he dropped to 21 goals and 21 assists for 42 points. So it's a fair bit of difference there in his offensive production. He played 81 games, so it wasn't due to missing time or anything of that nature. So obviously the Wild are looking to cut some costs, they're looking to change things up, and he is a prime target to likely be moved, especially where they were that close to trading him at the deadline. And obviously the Flames are very interested. Hard to say what the return was going back the other way. Likely was a younger player or some picks involved. So wouldn't be surprised to see those two teams reignite those trade talks. And if a guy like Zucker is going in, at this point I think that James Neal contract would likely have to go out, if not to Minnesota, which I can't imagine they would want that. Then they'd have to move him somewhere else or find another way to shed some salary off their books here, because it just would be hard for them to squeeze that in, especially where they have the Matthew Tkachuk contract extension kicking in here as well that they have to get sorted out this summer. So expect the Flames to be quite busy. Expect GM Paul Fenton to be busy with the Wild, and I fully suspect David Poile to be quite busy with the Predators. Unfortunately, there's only one Stanley Cup winner every year. So I do expect a very, very busy offseason, especially with the large number of RFAs that need new contracts and a lot of big name players that potentially could be moved this offseason. Of course, as always, I want to hear your thoughts and your opinions on what we discussed here today. What are your thoughts on the type of moves that these teams need to make to get better for next year? And of course, if these players are on the go, where would be a good landing spot? Maybe give me your opinion on a mock trade down below in the comments. We can discuss if that trade makes sense and if it's something that the team should pursue. If you're new to the channel, I hope you consider subscribing. We cover all 31 NHL teams, and there's plenty of content here for all hockey fans to enjoy. So if you're new, subscribe for more videos just like this one, as well as plenty of coverage of the 2019 Stanley Cup playoffs and all kinds of videos coming up about the 2019 NHL draft here, as well as we approach that coming up in June. As always, thank you for watching, and we will catch you next time.